Hello everyone, welcome to Teaching Pathshala. Today's topic of discussion is about the diastomonic acid and its signaling pathway. And this topic we are discussing in the 7th part of phytohormone. If you have not seen rest of the 6th part, then I will mention the link in the description box as well as in the end of this video. We are studying this topic for the preparation of CSIR NET, and along with that, the students who are preparing for their GATE Life Science, this topic will be beneficial for them too, as well as for the students who are preparing or pursuing for their MSc and the BSc courses. Let's start with the introductory portion of diastomonic acid, and in short form we used to call it as a JA, and JA stands for the diastomonic acid. So it's an organic compound found in several plants including the jasmine, and it was think that the smell of a jasmine is just due to the diastomonic acid. Second point is that this diastomonic acid or JA is a member of a jasmonate class of phytohormone or the plant hormone. So there is a phytohormone class which is known as a jasmonate, and this diastomonic acid is a member of that class. Third point is JA or the diastomonic acid and its methyl ester, which is known as the methyl diastomonate, are naturally occurring regulator of a higher plants. That means they are going to work as a phytohormone in a plant, that is the diastomonic acid as well as the methyl diastomonate. The property of methyl diastomonate is that it is a volatile compound and it used to present in a essential oil. Next point is the highest level of a JA or the methyl diastomonate are reported in a flower and the reproductive tissue, whereas much lower level are found in roots and the mature leaves. In flower and reproductive tissue, you are going to see a very high concentration or very high level of a diastomonic acid, or it may be a methyl diastomonate. And if you talk about the low level, so there is a very low level of diastomonic acid in root as well as in a mature leaves. More few properties of diastomonate is that it used to induce senescence and it used to promote the leaf absorption. And one more point is that at a concentration that is greater than the 50 micromolar, diastomonate induces the senescence in a plant cell culture. Okay, and this senescence response include a loss of a chlorophyll and degradation of a chloroplast protein. With this, we can say that it's depend upon the diastomonic acid concentration that whether it is going to inhibit some growth or whether it is going to promote some growth. It's totally depend on the concentration of that. If it is going to be used in a very high concentration, it is going to show some other effect. And if it is going to be used in a very low concentration, then it is going to show some different effect. Now let's talk about the biosynthesis of diastomonic acid. So this diastomonic acid used to synthesize from a linoleic acid, which is a type of a fatty acid, by the octadecanoid pathway. The alpha linolenic acid is going to act as a precursor molecule for the diastomonic acid synthesis. So first of all, the overall reaction is going to start with the alpha linolenic acid, and it is going to be oxygenated by the help of an enzyme which is known as a lipoxygenase, and this lipoxygenase is going to help to convert this alpha linolenic acid into a peroxide. After that, there is a cyclization in a presence of the alene oxide synthase, and this peroxide will going to convert into a alene oxide with the help of a alene oxide synthase enzyme. Then after that, there is a process that is the alene oxide rearrangement by the help of a alene oxide cyclase enzyme, and this alene oxide cyclase enzyme will going to convert this alene oxide into a 12-oxophytodionic acid. In short form, we used to call it as a OPDA. Till this process, all the different steps are taking place in a plastid, or you can say that in a chloroplast. And after the synthesis of a OPDA, now this OPDA is going to enter inside a peroxisome, and after that there will be a reduction process with the help of a reductase enzyme, and that will be going to be followed by a series of 6 beta oxidation. And then after this reductase enzyme action and the 6 beta oxidation process, there will be the conversion or there will be the generation of a diastomonic acid in a peroxisome. So what you have to remember, actually you have to remember all the different intermediate of this biosynthesis pathway, as well as what are the different process that is taking place. Like in the first step there is a oxygenation, in the second step there is a cyclization, in the third step there is a rearrangement, in the fourth step there is a reduction, and in the fifth step there is a beta oxidation. So you have to remember all this process and its name along with the different intermediate compound. And second thing what you have to remember, that till which process it is going to take place inside a chloroplast, and from where it is going to continue into the peroxisome. So from alpha linolenic acid to the OPDA, it is going to take place into a chloroplast, and after the synthesis of this OPDA, now this OPDA is going to enter into a peroxisome, and then this OPDA is going to convert into a diastomonic acid with the help of a reduction as well as the series of beta oxidation process. Now we are going to study about the diastomonic acid signaling pathway. So first of all, we are going to see the pathway in the absence of diastomonic acid. So there is total 2 factor. First is the JAZ, or you can say that the JAZ, which is going to act as an inhibitor, and the JAZ is stand for the diastomonate zym domain. So it is going to act as an inhibitor. Second factor is the MYC2 or MYC2, whatever you can say. It is a type of a transcription factor which is going to help in a transcription of a jasmonic acid responsive gene. So now let's see what is going to happen when there is a no jasmonic acid. So initially, when there is a no jasmonic acid, this inhibitor, that is the JAS, it is going to bind with the MYC2 and inhibit the overall transcription of the jasmonic acid responsive gene. So there is a no transcription, that means there is a no overall plant growth or plant response that is going to depend upon the jasmonic acid. Now let's see what happened when there is a presence of a jasmonic acid. But before that, I would like to mention you that the jasmonic acid is also going to follow the pathway of 26S proteasome degradation, or you can say that the ubiquitination and the 26S proteasome degradation pathway. In the previous video, while studying about the auxin signaling pathway, we have studied about what is 26S proteasome degradation, what is ubiquitination, what is FBOX, what is SKP1. So all that detail I'm not going to describe in this video because that thing I have already covered. Now you know the basic behind the ubiquitination, what is ubiquitination, how this ubiquitination is going to help in the protein degradation, and what is 26S proteasome degradation. So the point is that all the pathways will going to remain same. That means the process of ubiquitination as well as the 26S proteasome degradation. So we have seen that there is total three pathway which is going to follow this ubiquitination and the 26S proteasome complex, that is the auxin, jasmonic acid and the gibberellin. Now let's see what is going to happen when there is a presence of a jasmonic acid. So when there is a presence of a jasmonic acid, at that time this jasmonic acid is going to mediate the JAS translocation to a ubiquitination. That means now the JAS is going to be ubiquitinated with the help of a ubiquitin protein, and finally it is going to enter or translocate on a 26S proteasome, and finally there will be the degradation of this inhibitory protein. Due to the degradation of this inhibitory protein, now the MYC2, which is a type of a transcription factor, it is going to be activated, and finally it is going to help the jasmonic acid responsive genes for their transcription, and finally there will be the jasmonate regulated gene transcription will going to take place, and at the last stage the plant is going to show the jasmonic acid mediated response. So here also there will be the ubiquitination of the inhibitory protein, and after that the transcription factor is going to be activated, and finally it will lead to the transcription of the important genes that is going to play a very important role during a plant response, that is going to show their actual response toward this jasmonic acid phytohormone. So in this way, the jasmonic acid signaling pathway is also going to follow the 26S proteasome complex as well as the ubiquitination pathway. So in this way, we have completed the signaling pathway of a jasmonic acid 2. And I think this is the most easiest signaling pathway in all over this phytohormone series. So now let's move to the next portion, that is the function of jasmonic acid. So the first point is the jasmonic acid help in the regulation of a plant response to abiotic and the biotic stress. And I think this fact has been known by many students because they used to play a very, very important role in the biotic stress as well as the abiotic stress. Next point is, it used to help in the plant growth and development, and there is nothing to explain in that. Third point is, it used to help in the growth inhibition, senescence, flower development and the leaf abscission. So sometime depending upon the concentration, they are going to show the inhibition in the growth of a plant. Next, they are going to promote the senescence. So senescence means that it is a deterioration that ends the functional life of a plant, and that will be known as the senescence. Or in normal way, you can see that it is the natural aging of a plant in which it is going to lose all of its main functional property. So that is what called the senescence. Next, it is going to help in the flower development and the leaves abscission. Leaf abscession means the falling of a leaves, that I think you have seen that during some particular season there is a falling of a leaf. So if you apply a jasmonic acid to that kind of a plant, they are going to show the early leaf abscission. The next most important point about the function is that jasmonic acid used to inhibit the pollen germination. And this you have to remember, because I think I didn't remember the year, but in some of the attempt of CSINET, it was mentioned that which phytohormone is going to help in the inhibition of a pollen germination. And I think they have manipulated that question with some other statements too, but somehow they want to know that which phytohormone is going to play an important role in the inhibition of a pollen germination. So obviously it would be a jasmonic acid. Next point is, jasmonic acid is also responsible for the tuber formation in a potatoes. And along with that, the jasmonic acid used to act against the pest and the herbivores. So that means the plant which is going to have the high amount of jasmonic acid production, obviously there will be the low consumption of that kind of a plant with different herbivores, and there will be less attack of pest on that kind of a plant. Next function is that the seed treatment with jasmonic acid for the anti-pest defense in a plant. So the concept is that In some area, it has been seen during our practices that if we used to treat a seed with a jasmonic acid, then the plant which is going to grow from that seed will be going to show the anti-pest defense mechanism for some period of a time. So that was seen during our practice or during the different studies about the jasmonic acid. Next point is role of jasmonic acid in plant development and response to the environmental signals that used to include a many different kind of a stress condition. The next function is jasmonic acid inhibit the root growth and induces the tuber formation that we have just seen in case of a potato, that they are used to induce the tuber formation and they used to inhibit the overall root growth. Jasmonate can also induce the tendrils coiling. Tendril coiling is induced by the mechanical stimulation, and the role for auxin and the ethylene have been proposed. So the students who don't know about the tendrils, so in botany, a tendrils is a specialized stem or it may be a specialized leaf with a thread-like shape that is used by a climbing plant for their support or for their attachment. The area which has been represented or enlightened with a circle, that part is representing the tendrils. So you can see the tendrils in different type of plant like watermelon, and I think it is also present in pea plant. So you are going to see many more different examples of tendrils, but somehow the meaning of the tendrils I have already informed you, and I have shown you on pictures also, so that it will be easier for you to understand that what is tendrils. Next function is that the jasmonate can stimulate the ethylene biosynthesis, which is also a type of a phytohormone, by inducing the activity of an ethylene forming enzyme. That means the jasmonate is going to induce the activity of an ethylene forming enzyme, and as a result there will be the ethylene biosynthesis. So somehow we are going to see a role of a jasmonate during the ethylene biosynthesis. Jasmonate has been shown to stimulate the fruit ripening, most likely through its action on the ethylene biosynthesis. And I think this fact has been known by us, I think from our class 11th. We are studying this fact that the ethylene used to do a fruit ripening. So as because the jasmonate is going to help ethylene in a biosynthesis process, obviously the function of this ethylene and jasmonate somehow will be, I think, little bit related. That is why it has been indicated the jasmonate is also going to show the fruit ripening activity. Next function is jasmonate stimulate the conversion of a lycopene to 3-carotene. This lycopene is a type of a bright red carotene, and it is going to be present in a tomato and other different red fruits and vegetables. The last function is it is an essential mediator in triggering some plant response to abiotic stress, including the drought, salinity and cold. And this is again a most important point, that the jasmonic acid is going to show the response to some abiotic stresses like drought. That means the lack of water, then salinity as well as the cold stress. So question answer discuss करने से पहले मैं आपको एक information actually देना चाहती हूँ. First of all कि net का form निकल चुका है. I think उसका last date है 15th of October. तो obviously जो भी student interested है या फिर preparation कर रहे हैं वो net का form जल्दी से जल्दी भर दीजिए आप. I think डेट भी एक्सटेंड होती है, बट somehow आप उस पर डिपेंड नहीं रह सकते हैं. तो 15 October जो है वो लास्ट डेट है, तो उससे पहले आप फॉर्म भर लीजिए. और दूसरी बात जो मुझे कहनी है वो है रिक्वेस्टेड वीडियो के बारे में. मुझे एक दिन में मोर देन 20 to 25 रिक्वेस्ट आ रही हैं डिफरेंट यूनिट से, डिफरेंट वीडियोस की. देखिए मैं बस इतना कहना चाहती हूँ कि आप मतलब हर एक इंसान, जो भी व्यूअर्स हैं मेरे, जो भी वो रिक्वेस्ट कर रहे हैं, ऑब्वियसली वो रिक्वेस्टेड वीडियो अवेलेबल होंगी, लेकिन उनमें थोड़ा टाइम लगेगा. क्योंकि ऑब्वियसली अगर आप रिक्वेस्ट कर रहे हैं और मेरा काम है कि मैं आपको एक पर्टिकुलर वीडियो प्रोवाइड कर पाऊँ, क्योंकि मैं हूँ ही यहाँ पे इसलिए, लेकिन वो सब चीज़ें थोड़ा टाइम लेती हैं. तो मैं बस इतना कहना चाहती हूँ कि आप प्लीज़ अपना पेशेंस लेवल बनाए रखिए. विथ टाइम मैं वो वीडियोज़ पक्का अपलोड करूँगी, फाइन. बट मेरा मेन इंटेंशन अभी फिलहाल का ये है कि दिसंबर नेट से पहले मैं आपको स्पेशली मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक को प्रोवाइड कर पाऊँ. क्योंकि आई थिंक 2 मंथ रह गए हैं, 2 मंथ में ऑब्वियसली पूरा सिलेबस तो नहीं खत्म हो सकता, दैट इज़ वेरी ऑब्वियस, लेकिन मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक एटलीस्ट हम लोग 40 to 50% तो कंप्लीट कर सकते हैं. तो मैं वही कराने की कोशिश कर रही हूँ. तो अभी फिलहाल के लिए मेरा टारगेट है कि मैं आपको मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक को प्रोवाइड कर पाऊँ. उसके बाद मैं रिक्वेस्टेड वीडियो को भी अपलोड करना धीरे धीरे स्टार्ट करूँगी. कुछ व्यूवर्स की जो रिक्वेस्टेड वीडियो है वो ऑलरेडी उस कैटेगरी में आती है, आई मीन जो कि इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक है उस कैटेगरी में आती है, तो ऑब्वियसली वो वीडियो अपलोड हो जाएंगी. लाइक फ्रॉग का लिम डेवलपमेंट हो गया, उसके बाद डिफरेंट चिक्स में जो एक्सिस फॉर्मेशन होता है वो हो गया. तो ये सब जो वीडियो है वो आपको मतलब आई थिंक दिसंबर नेट से पहले ही अवेलेबल हो जाएंगे. लेकिन और भी जो डिफरेंट टॉपिक है जो कि मतलब उतना ज़्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट नहीं है, ऑब्वियसली मैं उसको थोड़ा स्लोली प्रोवाइड कराऊंगी आपको, बट जो मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक है मैंने अभी उसको फिलहाल के लिए टारगेट कर रखा है. जैसे कि जो इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक हो गया प्लांट बायोलॉजी से, कोई डेप बायो से हो गया, उसके बाद कोई मॉलिक्यूलर बायोलॉजिस्ट हो गया, कोई बायोकेमिस्ट्री हो गया, तो इनमें से जो मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक है मैं पहले उसे प्रोवाइड करने की कोशिश करूंगी. उसके बाद मैं धीरे धीरे जो भी आपकी रिक्वेस्टेड वीडियो है मैं उसे प्रोवाइड करना स्टार्ट करूंगी. तो आपसे बस इतनी रिक्वेस्ट है कि प्लीज़ थोड़ा सा आप पेशेंस लेवल बनाए रखिए, मुझे थोड़ा वक्त दीजिए. क्योंकि मैं आपके सामने जो वीडियो रखती हूँ उस वीडियो के पीछे लगभग एक वीडियो मेरा मोर देन 12 आवर्स का टाइम लेता है, उसको पर्टिकुलर कंटेंट को उस वीडियो में डालने में, फिर रिकॉर्डिंग में, फिर एडिटिंग में, फिर फाइनल एडिटिंग में, उसके बाद वो वीडियो आपके सामने अवेलेबल हो पाता है। तो ये सब चीज़ें थोड़ा टाइम लेती हैं। रिकॉर्डिंग जब मैं करती हूँ तो रिकॉर्डिंग में ही मेरा मोर देन 2 आवर्स जाता है। तो वीडियो बनाना एक अलग चीज़ है, उसके बाद उसको रिकॉर्डिंग करने में इतना टाइम जाता है। तो आप सोच सकते हैं कि एक पर्टिकुलर वीडियो में कितना ज़्यादा टाइम लगता है। तो मैं उसी टाइम के अकॉर्डिंग आपको वीडियो अवेलेबल करा सकती हूँ और फ्यूचर में भी कराती रहूँगी। बस मैं इतना ही कह रही हूँ कि आप थोड़ा मेरे साथ कॉपरेट कीजिए, क्योंकि मैं भी यहाँ पे हूँ आपकी हेल्प के लिए ही, और मैं पूरी कोशिश कर रही हूँ कि आपकी हेल्प कर पाऊँ। बस मैं आपसे इतना चाहती हूँ कि आप अपना पेशेंस लेवल बनाए रखिए। सो नाउ लेट्स मूव टू द क्वेश्चन। सो द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन वी हैव टेकन फ्रॉम द 2017 दिसंबर। सो द क्वेश्चन इज विच वन ऑफ द फॉलोइंग इज द करेक्ट फंक्शन ऑफ जैज, विच इज अ जैस्मोनेट जिम डोमेन प्रोटीन फैमिली, अ की रेगुलेटर ऑफ अ जैस्मोनिक एसिड सिग्नलिंग रेस्पॉन्स। So what you have to tell is like you have to pick a correct function for the jazz. So the first option is it used to bind to the MYC2 and repress the jasmonic acid dependent genes. Somehow the first option seems to be correct, because obviously this jazz used to sit on the MYC2 and it used to inhibit this transcription factor so that it could not make a transcription of a jasmonic acid responsive gene or jasmonic acid dependent genes. But somehow let's move to the second option. It binds to the MYC2 and transcribe the jasmonic acid dependent genes. So this option is totally wrong, because first of all, this jazz is going to act as the inhibitor, not the enhancer. So second option is totally wrong. Third option is it used to act as a receptor of jasmonic acid signal. So this is totally wrong, because this is going to act as an inhibitor, not the receptor. Fourth option is it involved in directly inducing a jasmonic acid dependent genes. No, it is not. First of all, it is not directly involved. Second is that it is not going to induce the jasmonic acid dependent genes. It used to inhibit that overall genes. So with this explanation, we came to know that the first option is the correct option. That is, it used to bind to MYC2 and it used to transcribe jasmonic acid dependent genes. And this thing we have already seen when we were studying about the signaling pathway of jasmonic acid. The second question is from CSIRnet 2011. So the question is, following are some statements for synthesis of jasmonic acid in plants. And in the last line, they have given that which one of the following combination of above statement is correct. So somehow we have to pick a correct combination of a statement. So let's start. So statement A is 12-oxophytodionic acid is produced in chloroplast and transported to the peroxisome. So this statement is totally correct, because this compound, that is the 2-oxophytodionic acid, they used to produce in a chloroplast, and finally they used to transport into a peroxisome. And after that, it is going to follow the process of reduction, and that will be followed by a beta oxidation, and final result will be the jasmonic acid production. So somehow the statement A is totally correct. इसके साथ हम elimination methods भी देख लेते हैं, ताकि अगर जिस students को अच्छे से नहीं पता elimination method, वो उसको सीख जाए। जैसे कि हमने बोला कि जो statement A है वो 100% correct है, और हम इसके लिए भी 100% sure हैं। तो अगर हम A के लिए 100% sure हैं, तो हम एटलीस्ट उन ऑप्शन को एलिमिनेट कर सकते हैं जिसमें कि ए अवेलेबल नहीं है। जैसे कि ऑप्शन नंबर 2 और 3 में ए नहीं है, तो मतलब ये हुआ कि 2 और 3 कभी भी करेक्ट ऑप्शन नहीं हो सकते हैं। तो हमने इजीली 2 ऑप्शन को एलिमिनेट कर दिया, तो इससे क्या हुआ, हमारी गलतियां होने के चांसेस अब कम होंगे, क्योंकि पहले जो प्रोबेबिलिटी थी वो थी 25% फॉर ईच ऑप्शन, अब हो गई 50-50%। तो क्या हुआ, हमने अपनी एक्यूरेसी बढ़ा ली, अब हमने गलतियां करने की प्रोबेबिलिटी को कम कर लिया। अब हमारे पास जो ऑप्शन है वो हमें 50-50% की प्रोबेबिलिटी देंगे। अब कहने का मतलब ये हुआ, या तो फर्स्ट ऑप्शन करेक्ट है या तो लास्ट ऑप्शन करेक्ट है, क्योंकि हमने सेकंड और थर्ड ऑप्शन को इजीली एलिमिनेट कर दिया, क्योंकि उसमें ए प्रेजेंट नहीं है, और ए के लिए हम 100% श्योर हैं कि जो ए स्टेटमेंट है वो टोटली करेक्ट है। तो इस वे में हमने सेकंड और थर्ड ऑप्शन को एलिमिनेट कर दिया। अब हमारे पास जो बचा है वो है फर्स्ट और फोर्थ ऑप्शन। तो फर्स्ट और फोर्थ ऑप्शन में से ही कोई एक ऑप्शन जो है वो सही होगा। तो हमने एलिमिनेशन मेथड सीख लिया। एक और ट्रिक देखते हैं, जैसे कि आप, हम तो अब श्योर हो गए कि फर्स्ट और फोर्थ ऑप्शन में से ही कोई एक करेक्ट ऑप्शन होगा। अब फर्स्ट और फोर्थ ऑप्शन को आप ध्यान से देखिए। तो फर्स्ट ऑप्शन में है ए बी सी और फोर्थ ऑप्शन में है ए सी ई। तो समहाउ जो डी है वो किसी भी ऑप्शन में नहीं है, मतलब कि फर्स्ट और फोर्थ ऑप्शन में से किसी भी ऑप्शन में डी नहीं है। तो इसका मतलब क्या हुआ कि जो डी स्टेटमेंट है वो गलत है, तभी ये इन दोनों ऑप्शन में नहीं है, क्योंकि हमें बोला गया है करेक्ट ऑप्शन पिक करने के लिए। तो ये भी एक तरीका होता है जिससे कि हम अपनी गलतियों को, मतलब होने की जो प्रोबेबिलिटी होती है उसको कम कर देते हैं। तो इजीली हम ये लेके चल सकते हैं कि जो डी ऑप्शन है वो गलत है, क्योंकि ये दोनों ऑप्शन में नहीं दिया गया है। और अगर हम डी ऑप्शन को देखें तो उसमें लिखा गया है कि फाइनल प्रोडक्ट ऑफ जैस्मोनिक एसिड विल टेक प्लेस इन क्लोरोप्लास्ट। नो, क्योंकि जैस्मोनिक एसिड का जो प्रोडक्शन होता है वो पेरीऑक्सीजोम में होता है, क्लोरोप्लास्ट में नहीं होता है। क्लोरोप्लास्ट से 12-ऑक्सोफाइटोडायोनिक एसिड जो है वो क्या करता है, वो पेरीऑक्सीजोम में मूव कर जाता है, फिर वहां से जैस्मोनिक एसिड का प्रोडक्शन होता है पेरीऑक्सीजोम में। तो बहुत इजीली हमने डी ऑप्शन भी एलिमिनेट कर दिया, और somehow हमें पहले से ही इंडिकेशन मिल गया था कि डी ऑप्शन जो है वो गलत होने वाला है, क्योंकि ना तो वो फर्स्ट ऑप्शन में था ना ही वो फोर्थ ऑप्शन में था। नाउ लेट्स मूव टू द बी स्टेटमेंट। एक्शन ऑफ अ लाइपोक्सीजिनेज एलीन ऑक्साइड सिंथेज एंड एलीन ऑक्साइड साइक्लेज टेक प्लेस इन पेरीऑक्सीजोम। सो दिस स्टेटमेंट इज टोटली रॉन्ग, Because the action of this lipoxygenase, alanine oxide synthase, and alanine oxide cyclase, all three genes used to do their action in a chloroplast, not the peroxisome. In peroxisome, there is a function of a reductase enzyme as well as there is a occurrence of a beta oxidation. So this statement is totally wrong. So we can easily able to eliminate the B option. Or agar hum first option dekhe to usme B included hai. तो हम तो इस चीज के लिए 100% श्योर हैं कि बी स्टेटमेंट भी गलत है. तो हम इजीली जो है वो फर्स्ट ऑप्शन को एलिमिनेट करके फोर्थ ऑप्शन को चूज कर सकते हैं कि हाँ ये ऑप्शन सही है. बट समहाउ हमें इस बात का क्लैरिफिकेशन होना चाहिए कि एज बिकॉज फोर्थ ऑप्शन में ई सी और ई इंक्लूडेड है तो हमें सी और ई स्टेटमेंट को एक बार देखना पड़ेगा कि वो एक्चुअल में सही है या नहीं है. बट ट्रिक के हिसाब से हमारा जो करेक्ट आंसर होना चाहिए वो होना चाहिए फोर्थ, क्योंकि जो बी स्टेटमेंट है उसको हमने गलत साबित कर दिया. तो फर्स्ट ऑप्शन में जो है वो बी इंक्लूडेड है जबकि फोर्थ ऑप्शन में बी नहीं है. तो समहाउ ये इंडिकेशन दे रहा है कि हमारा फोर्थ ऑप्शन जो है वो करेक्ट होने वाला है. बट हम ईच एंड एवरी स्टेटमेंट को देखेंगे और उसका सही होना या गलत होने को हम सिग्निफाई करेंगे. द सी स्टेटमेंट इज 12 ऑक्सो फाइटोडायोनिक एसिड इज द फर्स्ट रिड्यूस्ड एंड देन कन्वर्टेड टू अ जैस्मोनिक एसिड बाय बीटा ऑक्सीडेशन. सो दिस स्टेटमेंट इज ऑल्सो करेक्ट बिकॉज फर्स्ट स्टार्टिंग में क्या होता है 12 ऑक्सो फाइटोडायोनिक एसिड का पहले रिडक्शन होता है विद द हेल्प ऑफ अ रिडक्टेस एंजाइम और उसके बाद बीटा ऑक्सीडेशन प्रोसेस को फॉलो करके फाइनली दैट पर्टिकुलर कंपाउंड इज गोइंग टू कन्वर्ट इनटू अ जैस्मोनिक एसिड. सो दिस सी स्टेटमेंट इज टोटली करेक्ट. D statement we have already eliminated in our previous discussion. The E statement is action of the alanine oxide synthase and alanine oxide cyclase take place in chloroplast, obviously. So this statement is also correct. So with this we came to know that fourth option is the correct option, that is the which is going to have a combination of a statement like A, C and E. तो इस वे में आज हमने क्वेश्चन भी सॉल्व कर लिया और दो ट्रिक्स भी सीख लिए. आई नो काफ़ी स्टूडेंट्स को ये ट्रिक्स पता होंगे और जिनको नहीं पता है आई थिंक उनके लिए काफ़ी हेल्पफुल रहा होगा, क्योंकि मेरे पास इस बात की भी रिक्वेस्ट आ रही थी कि मैं सेक्शन सी को कैसे सॉल्व करना है उसके बारे में एक वीडियो बनाऊं. बट समहाउ मैं प्लान कर रही हूँ कि हाँ ऐसा कुछ वीडियो बनाऊं ताकि मैक्सिमम स्टूडेंट्स को इससे बेनिफिट मिल सके, क्योंकि कुछ कुछ ट्रिक्स ऐसे हैं जो कि आई थिंक बहुत कम स्टूडेंट्स को पता है. बट लेट्स सी, मैं कोशिश करूँगी कि मैं जल्दी से जल्दी वो वीडियो आपके लिए अवेलेबल करा पाऊँ एंड आई होप ये वीडियो आपके लिए काफ़ी हेल्पफुल रहा होगा. So if this video was helpful for you, then you can hit that like button. You can share this video with your friends who are preparing for the CSI and NET examination. And if you're new to my channel, then don't forget to subscribe my channel and you can hit that bell icon so that you will be notified with my each and every new video uploads. Thank you for watching this video.